So the third video in our North Carolina camp series is going to be on Cherokee Council camps. Scouting started in Burlington, North Carolina during the teens, but no record of councils preceding Cherokee Council have been found. In 1923, David Ballard was hired to be the first scout executive for the newly formed Cherokee Council. So Cherokee Council started off as a first-class council in 1923, and it existed until 1994. The area that was formerly served by Cherokee Council is now served by Old North State Council. The first summer camp held by Cherokee Council was at Grant Springs in 1923. The camp was likely private property used by the scouts during the summer. Bruce Carter, who had joined scouting in 1910, was the camp director. Few records of the camp remain, and it may have only been used in 1923. In 1925, Camp Loch Lilly was used as a summer camp by local scouts. The camp was located northwest of Roxboro in Person County. The first permanent summer camp was Camp Cherokee, built around 1925 in Wentworth. The land was leased from Rockingham County. In 1936, the Works Progress Administration constructed a log building that was used as the dining hall. The dining hall was later used as the Order of the Arrow building and still exists today. In 1966, Camp Cherokee closed, and the council purchased a piece of property near Yanceyville that would later be named Cherokee Scout Reservation. On the screen, you'll see two Camp Cherokee patches and a feather. I believe these to be the earliest Camp Cherokee items in collections. I believe these pieces are likely from the 20s. And as far as I'm aware, they are both one known in collections. I am not sure if other color varieties may exist. So the one on the left, which is in my collection, is green on red felt, and the other one is red on what appears to be a dark blue, maybe a purple felt. I'm not sure what the feathers may indicate. It could have been some sort of achievement at camp, I don't know. And I'm not sure how many feathers maybe were worn under it. I just don't know that information, and we may never know. Then you have the arrowheads. So here are four different arrowheads from Camp Cherokee. These are the ones in my collection. I believe all of these pieces are from the 30s. I don't know of an exact date. I have them in this order because this is the order on John Kenney's board where he has a display of Camp Cherokee items out at the Cherokee Scout Reservations Museum. And in general, I'm going to assume John Kenney is right as far as having these in the correct order they were issued. I do know I've seen a picture of the Camp Cherokee on the end. I've seen a picture of that one on a sash with some 1937 items. As far as rarity, I would say that the first one and the last one on this page, so the green felt that's embroidered and the embroidered on twill, I would say that those two are probably the most common of these. I've seen maybe four or five, I think, of each of them, maybe even six or so of the first one. The second one that's silk screened, I've seen, I want to say, maybe three or four of. Now the third one, which is with the white silk screen, I think I've only seen two of those. I'm not sure why that one is harder than the others in particular. Then we get into these. The first two that are twills with cut edge, I've heard the one on the left, someone described me one time as from the 30s. I just think that it's from the 40s. I mean, I really think both of those issues are somewhere in that mid-40s era. The first twill, which kind of looks like a firecracker twill, even though Cherokee Scout Reservation and Camp Cherokee, they never had firecrackers as far as I'm aware. But that's what the patch kind of looks like, that design. I believe I've seen half a dozen to 10 over time and over multiple collections that have come up for sale over different years. It's still hard, but it's not, in my opinion, as hard as the earlier couple earlier pieces. Then you have the Camp Cherokee that's kind of almost that generic design with that teepee in the middle and the two fires, one on each side. That one, I don't have it. I actually need one, and it seems to be very difficult. I did not personally think it was from the Camp Cherokee in North Carolina. I suspected it was from outside of North Carolina, that it was from a different Camp Cherokee, because there are some outside of North Carolina. However, I was told by someone local that it was from the North Carolina Camp Cherokee, but it does seem to be fairly difficult. I have not seen one available for sale, to my knowledge, since I started collecting, but I could have missed it. Then you get into these silk-screened yearly ones. So you've got a 49, you've got a 50, and then you have the Longe Turner, which was the camp award. 1950 camper would have had the Longe Turner if you earned it, could have gone under your 1950 camper. And then they did not have a Longe Turner in 51. I've heard people tell me that there was one, but after years of looking, talking to people who have been looking and collecting that area, I think that the couple people who thought they had seen one, I think they were mistaken. I do not think there is a 1951 Longe Turner. So then you have the 1952 Camp Cherokee, which is in the shape of a snow globe. At least that's how I kind of look at it. Now, there is a Longe Turner segment, that blue felt log that goes below the 1952 patch, but that will be the last Longe Turner patch that goes to these felts. So there is no Longe Turner that goes to the 1953. Now let's look back for 1 minute. We've got the 1950 Camp Cherokee. You'll notice that first one with the really fine details on the silk screen. It's the red silk screen on the white felt. You'll also notice that there is a red felt with white silk screen. I got both of those at the same time in a collection, and there wasn't really any explanation of what they were, but just by handling it and looking at it, I knew immediately that the white silk screen on red is a fake. And I talked to some other people later, and they said, "Oh, you know, yeah, that you're right, that is what that is." And no one really knew who made them or why they were made or what was going on with that, but the white silk screen on red is very clearly, you can tell by handling the material that it's much newer material, the details aren't right, and obviously the colors are inverted. So just be aware that there is that fake. I don't know if any other ones were ever faked. If you ever have a question or you're concerned about a patch, always feel free to send me an email or something. I also will touch on real quick the Camp Cherokee 1949 Honor Camper Neckerchief Slide. I've seen that in collections a couple times from this area, and I've always thought it was a really neat piece. I don't have any particular history on it other than exactly what it says on the neckerchief slide. I will say that I think that the two Longe Turner felts are harder than the normal camper every year felts. All of these patches are fairly desirable. Camp Cherokee is a heavily collected camp, but like I said, I think that maybe the felts aren't quite as good as the first two twills on this page, and I don't think the twills are as good as the earlier issues from the previous, you know, kind of going back to the adage of the older the better. So here are some other Camp Cherokee issues starting in 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, and then we go to these two twill arrowheads. You'll notice that the two twill arrowheads are basically the same design as the 54, 55. If anyone knows the story of why they switched two arrowheads and then back to that kind of snow globe shape and then back to arrowheads again later, I'd love to know the story. I'm sure it's interesting. Some people probably only have one of the twill arrowheads in your collection. I think that's fine. Personally, I thought there was a minor variety. If you look at the eyebrow on the Native American chief, you can see one's very flat, one curves. If you look at his nose and his mouth and, you know, just some of the facial details, you can kind of notice that they look a little bit different. So, me being me, I saw a little bit of a difference. I said, "Ooh, I want to have both of them," so I just kept them. Now, in 1958, they did use this camp staff. kind of an arc. And you'll notice I put a picture here. That's the camp staff from 1958. And you can see on their right uniform sleeve, you can see the patch. Now, this patch was used all across the country, and there are other years. I don't know that any other years were used at Cherokee, but I know the 58 was. So if you're going to have your Cherokee collection, you do need to have one of these in your Cherokee collection because it was worn by the staff that year. Now, here are two neckerchiefs. I've said before, but most of my camp items I keep in that 1910 to 1960 range. Sometimes I go a little over that, but that's generally where I am. The only dated neckerchief I'm aware of, I think in my entire North Carolina collection, that's a dated pre-1960, is this 1958 Camp Cherokee staff neckerchief. That is absolutely one of my favorite neckerchiefs in my collection. It is just so cool looking. They're fairly hard. I've seen maybe two or three. Now, the one on the left is just an arrowhead that's been put on a neckerchief. Every now and then for different camps, I'll see camp patches sewn on neckerchiefs. Whenever I see those, I usually try to pick them up if they're not very expensive. A lot of times they can be got for around the same price as the patch on the neckerchief. I've always thought they're neat. A lot of times you'll hear stories about, oh, well, you know, little Johnny's mom put his patch on a neckerchief and that's all that is. Well, that might be true, but I've also heard stories every now and then of, oh yeah, you know, the staff that year had this color neckerchief, or they had, you know, that plain neckerchief, and oh, they put the patch on. So I kind of always err on the side of caution, and whenever I see things like that, I always just try to pick them up. So if you have any unique items like that, I'd love to see them. If you ever have a story about something like that that you see in one of these videos, please do contact me because I'd love to hear it. So these are kind of the next series. You get these, it's, you know, the two Native Americans in the canoe, you've got the red bordered patch, you got a yellow border patch, you've got a red border patch with the 1966, and there's a couple little varieties, but I've always thought that especially the neckerchiefs looked pretty, and I'm not quite sure when this series started. I know it was somewhere in, you know, the 60s. Which is pretty evident just from the fact that they have a rolled edge on them, and rolled edges didn't really come out until the 60s. But you've got a couple different neckerchiefs here, a couple different of these rounds, and I'm sure there are some more of the neckerchiefs. I also just wanted to show you this pennant. You can see it looks like it would be really old, like 1930s, just from the felt, and it's kind of moth-eaten a little bit. And in the middle of that fleur-de-lis is that two Indian design, and it says Cherokee Council Camps. And going back, you can see that that's the exact same way the patches are. So that Cherokee Council Camps and the fact that it's on the pennant, they didn't have multiple camps until the 50s. We'll get into that in just a minute. So I don't think that the pennant is as early as you might think at first glance. I think it's probably from the 60s. That being said, I would sure love to find one if anyone knows where one is. This picture is from John Kenny, I believe. Now, some of you may have seen this patch. This is a 1949 Camp Cherokee patch, but it was not made by Cherokee Council. I'll have this in the General Green Council video. I just wanted to put it here just in case. So if you had it and you thought, oh, well, I have a 49 Camp Cherokee patch that's different from the one he showed. Well, if it's this one, it's the General Green Council who made this patch for their boys who attended Camp Cherokee in 1949 because they didn't have a camp they could send their own boys to. In 1952, construction was completed on the John H. Carr Dam. A 50,000-acre lake was formed on the border of North Carolina and Virginia. The body of water was known as either Bugs Island Lake or Carr Lake. In 1954, the council held a summer camp for explorers in the Grassy Creek area on Bugs Island Lake. The camp was a success, and permission was obtained from the Army Corps of Engineers to use a small island on the lake. A permanent camp was then built. In 1955, the camp was named Twin Harbors. From 1956 to 1959, patches were issued that say Cherokee Council Explorer Base. In 1960, the camp was renamed for a local pediatrician, Donald E. Robinson, who taught sailing at camp. The last council camp run at the property was in 1965. So, what you have is an explorer base at Carr Lake, 1954 to 65, but it operated under several different names. So I've kind of tried to show that laid out on this slide. And then here you can see from 54 to 61, you can see the first patch that actually says Bugs Island Camp. Then the second one says Camp Twin Harbors, and then the others. I don't know that any of these are really in particularly rarer than the others. I've always thought of them as basically around the same amount of value. I know that I'm still missing a 59 and a 61, but I think all of them, to find them in good shape, probably about the same rarity. In 1947, Mr. Hugh Greed Scott donated 71 acres in southeastern Rockingham County to develop a camp for African American scouts. The camp was first used for 1 week in 1949, but no buildings existed at the site. The camp was closed in 1950. Several buses were donated to be used for housing. Seats were removed and bunk beds were installed. A dining hall was built in 1951 and camp was open for 2 1-week sessions. By 1956, camp was open for 4 weeks. Utilities, water, and electricity improvements were made in 1959. The camp was utilized until 1965. Here is what I've kind of done. I've kind of laid out what I know exists from Hugh Greed Scott. And then on the ones where it says no image, I don't know that a patch exists. I just wanted to kind of leave a spot for it. Now in 1950, I'm going to assume one does not exist because camp was closed that year. But I just kind of left the spot there. So 1949, that was the first year. And then I don't have anything there for 51 or 52. And they may not have made patches those years. I don't know. Then in 53, we have a patch image. 54, we have that Indian head design that they're going to reuse every year for a while. And then you have 55, I haven't seen one. 56, 57, and then 58. Now, I went maybe 3 years, I would say, somewhere around there. And I happened to be talking to someone. I mentioned Hugh Greed Scott. And they said, oh, well, I have a Hugh Greed Scott. And they sent me a picture. And they sent me a picture of 58. I'd never seen a picture of one before then. So I'm just saying, some of these patches, you could go years of looking for them. And then you may only get a picture. And that's still exciting to me. So if you have an image of anything I'm missing, please do send it to me. And I'll try to share it and, you know, we can all learn about these together. And then in 59, I don't have an image. 60, they go with this set, different design. 61, a different design. And no image of anything from 62 to 65. So Hugh Greed Scott, I don't know of any other segregated camp with this many dated patches. I mean, there may be another one, but not one from North Carolina. And it's, wow, a lot of patches. Very impressive patches. I personally do not have a single Hugh Greed Scott in my collection. That's probably the biggest hole, in my opinion, of my camp collection, is that I do not have a single Hugh Greed Scott patch. So I'm going to throw it out there that if anyone has any Hugh Greed Scott patch, I would be a buyer for $350 or more. So please do contact me because I would sure love to add some to my collection. I do think this is pretty interesting. This is a Hugh Greed Scott neckerchief from Old Hickory Council in 1960. So their boys must have gone to Camp Hugh Greed Scott because they weren't able to go to their segregated camp. I don't know why. That year, maybe their camp was closed, or it could be that maybe they were tired of going to their segregated camp and they wanted to go somewhere else, just like we go to the different camps today. I don't know, but this piece only turned up in the last year or two, maybe. It's amazing we're still finding pieces like this today that we never knew existed a couple years ago. So that's going to be it for the Cherokee Council Camps video. If you would, please contact me if you have pictures or patches that I did not show in the video. I'm also interested if anyone has paperwork, such as pamphlets and that kind of material from these camps. I'd really be interested in getting scans, or I'd be willing to purchase the original copy. Please remember to like the video and to subscribe to the channel. You can follow us on Facebook. If there's content you would like me to cover, if you comment it below, I will do a video on it.